Let's bring in American political commentator Peter Dominic in New York now. Peter, good morning to you. Boy, oh boy, what a day, huh?
Hey guys, hey Carl, hey Sarah. Yeah, it's been a long-awaited day for a whole bunch of Americans. And thank you for paying such close attention to the political circus here in America, because we really have no idea what's going down. Is there anything we need to know about you guys?
Well, look, I mean, it is a circus, that's for sure. That's what we've been taking in all morning. I mean, do you think, though, it's been quite a day, a very eventful day yet again in the life of Donald Trump. He's gone from New York, now touching down in Florida. Do you think this has been an energy-sapping day for him, or has he actually been galvanised by what's happened?
He's ready to explode.
Sarah, it sounds like you're asking me about Donald Trump's energy today. And I can't tell you about his energy, but I can tell you about his future and his mood. He is terrified, according to a lot of people that are close to the president. He can't believe, and frankly, neither can most Americans, we never thought we would see this day. I think he even woke up this morning thinking he was not going to have to go to that court. He's in such denial. So for him to sit there was a real cold reality for the former disgraced president of the United States of America. The first time he's ever been, any president's ever been held in a criminal trial. This is big, big deal.
Look, and he may have thought that, but now he's going to use it and maximize it. And you all who are anticipating this and hoping for it are stuck with it. We're still a year away from primaries. I mean, my God.
Thank you, Carl, to be an American in politics. Yeah, every day is a struggle when you think about what this can lead to. This is going to go on for like 3 more years. This case, it'll end up probably in an appeal to slap on the wrist. It'll end up paying a fine.
Yeah.
But there are several other cases that are far more serious, including that the federal government, the Department of Justice is looking into, that are far, far more serious. So he is going to be really in big trouble and losing a lot of energy, as you say. But more importantly, he's lost the last 3 elections in the United States of America.
Yeah.
He lost his own election, and he lost the midterm congressional election when he was president. He lost the last election, most of the candidates he supported. So he is losing support, losing momentum. And this, despite what anybody says about, yeah, he'll raise money, this is not good for him, guys. Mm. It's very bad for anybody to be indicted like this.
Okay, so what does this mean then for America? I mean, he's such a divisive figure, right? And so if this is to all collapse on him, what does it mean for the people of America and his supporters?
Well, for his supporters, it's obviously really, really difficult. But what it means for America is that we finally have a sense of accountability. You know, you can go back to Nixon being pardoned. You can talk about the Vietnam War. You can talk about the Iraq invasion. You can talk about the financial crisis, all of which affected your country. No one was held accountable for those things. I mean, Nixon was pardoned. America needs to hold powerful people accountable like other countries do, both in the private and public sector. And that's what we're doing. So in many ways, this is a really good day for America to hold someone so powerful accountable. Mm-hmm. This man who has wrought so much damage to our country, to its reputation. Accountability is a really important thing for any nation, for any powerful person. And he is facing just a little bit of justice today. And that is a good thing for America, although we'll remain divided. Mm. Let's not get carried away. Mm.
What else was on your show today?
Listen, it's important that we cover this. I mean, it's easy to look away, but it's important that we cover this.
100%.
I don't love going live with what he's about to say, because he'll just lie the whole time. We should fact check all of that because he's going to say whatever he wants to say. But this is occupying, as you can imagine, Carl. I mean, listen, if it's on your show, it's on our show.
100%. Good to have you on our show. And we'll talk to you very soon. Appreciate you being
Thanks
on.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Good on you, mate. Thank you so much. Thank you for joining us on this big news day as the former president of the United States, Donald Trump, appeared in front of a New York court pleading not guilty to 34 felony counts of falsifying business records. Welcome back to the show. You're looking at Florida and the ballroom at Mar-a-Lago in Florida, where Donald Trump is expected to deliver his first remarks since he's not entered the plea to 34 felony charges.
Let's bring in high-profile U.S. Attorney Ben Chu in Washington. Ben, thanks again for your time this morning. Now, Donald Trump is preparing to speak right now on very friendly turf at Mar-a-Lago, different to what we saw in New York. What do you think we can expect from him?
Well, first of all, Sarah and Carl, it's nice to be with you again. I think what we should expect today is from Mr. Trump is a lot of bombast. As you pointed out, he's before a friendly crowd, so that seems to invigorate him. But whatever rhetoric we hear from the former president tonight does not in any way diminish the serious nature of the charges that were emerged today. And when you put aside, you know, some of the esoteric nature of the 34 felony counts, and you open the aperture a little bit, I think what you have is a very compelling story about an attempt to cover up two illicit affairs in advance of the 2016 campaign. I think it's going to be a very compelling case to present to a jury that would otherwise be, you know, some dry financial records, you know, in the context of something that I think will be very easy for a jury to understand.
Yeah, I think it's certainly a little bit easier than I thought it was going to be. And also the forensic nature of the evidence against him is going to be pretty hard to argue against. I guess it's just the severity of it. But when you hear, I'm not sure whether you're aware, but while he was still on the plane on the tarmac in Florida, he gave an interview to a couple of significant pastors in the US saying, you know, that this was all fake and that he would be rallying against it. And the pastors themselves went on to say that there were institutional concerns with those particular charges, and also the very law and order courts that that the charges are being brought against Trump in front of. When you hear that kind of language, will it make any difference to what happens? Because Donald Trump is going to want this to make a difference, all this we're seeing now and the sideshow and the circus and the chaos. But will it make any difference at all to what's going to come in court in December and January of next year?
No, as one of your commentators said earlier today, he's not the ringmaster here. He's the ringmaster at Mar-a-Lago, but where it counts is in Manhattan. And the ringmaster in that courtroom is Judge Marchand. And Judge Marchand gave a pretty clear warning to the former president and his lawyers today that he better cut it out or there will be a gag order and a protective order entered. So I think if he persists in that kind of rhetoric, I think he risks severe consequences in court.
We know, John, that this is sort of just the first trial that Donald Trump is likely to face. We were anticipating whether there might be a gag order. There hasn't been, so he's really not restricted in what he can say. He's going to weaponize this, isn't he, given what's going to happen in Georgia and following the January 6th insurrection as well?
Yes, if past his prologue, I agree with you, Sarah. I think he is going to continue. And I think I do think that Judge Marchand made very clear that he would revisit the issue of a gag order if the president, the former president, persisted. I think the judge expressed a sensitivity to the fact that the former president is running for election again and therefore, you know, had in some ways heightened speech rights. But I don't think the judge will hesitate to drop the hammer if the president acts as irresponsibly as he did prior to January 6th. And as you pointed out, the president faces perhaps even more legal jeopardy in three separate investigations, one in Georgia for attempting to subvert the election result in that state, one for obstruction of justice with respect to his treatment of classified documents, and then, as you both alluded to, for allegedly inciting one of the worst days in our history, which left ultimately seven dead on January 6th. And those legal shoes have yet to drop. And in some ways, these cases are interrelated because you have overlapping areas of Trump conduct or alleged conduct, which is fairly consistent.
If you were looking for any indication, though, or the judge was, that he was going to use this incendiary kind of language to motivate and to jack up the public in relation to this, I mean, we've already got a taste of that on the plane, haven't we, when he called it a fake investigation, he called this a great day. And even if he doesn't incite violence, It's pretty clear that he's going to have plenty of people all along the way and plenty of organisations, some of these Bible Belt organisations and these pastors rallying the troops for him. So in a way, he's not going to have to do much in order to inspire people for anarchy.
No, I think he makes himself very clear. As Michael Cohen pointed out, he speaks in the clip language of the gangster. So I think he doesn't have to be explicit to make his orders clear. But I don't think, and maybe this is the trial lawyer in me, I don't think that's going to do him any good in the courtroom. And I think the courts have really what kept the American democracy vibrant, you know, in the era of Trump. The courts are the area where the former president has had the least success.
Yeah.
And I think they will continue to be. Many of the judges who ruled against him in many of these legal cases, shooting down the false claims about alleged election fraud, of which there was no substantial election fraud, were conservative judges who were appointed by President Trump himself, which I think is very encouraging about our judiciary, that most of these judges are judges first and political operatives second. So I'm going to continue to hold out that hope, because I think the judiciary is what will see us through.
Well, it's going to be tested, isn't it? I really appreciate you being with us as well. Thanks for your experience.